All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Super STEAM Saturday. And I just want to say before we get started that we do record these sessions. So you, if you don't want, you know, to be on that recording visible, you know, you don't have to have your webcam on. But if you're okay with that, you can leave your camera on. I just want to give you that little heads up. Today we have a very special guest. This is Dr. Emily Thompson, and she is here to talk about Fido and the gray wolf genetics and conservation genetics. So this should be a very interesting session today. And without further ado, I will turn it over to Dr. Thompson.
Well, thank you, Susan. Thank you very much. And y'all can interrupt by unmuting if you have a question, or you can write a question in a chat. And the question in the chat is most likely to get my attention. Actually, I'm a little hard of hearing right now. And we can do it anyway, either way. And I can also pause for questions. So you can call me Emily or Dr. T, and I teach genetics at Washtenaw Community College. I've been teaching genetics. I did it for 2 years in graduate school. And I've been teaching since 1992. So I love genetics, and I love learning a little bit more myself in order to prepare this set of slides. I have a lot of slides. I love to learn visually. So I'm going to share my slides with you, and I'll keep turning my slides on and off so that I can see you as well. All right. Okay. So this is all about Fido and the gray wolf, and a little bit about how what their genetics are, and then conservation genetics, which is about saving gray wolves in places where they need to be saved. And so as you can imagine, my first question for you is going to be then, there are three things we're going to talk about: genetics of dog coat color, saving the wolves of Isle Royale, and then I have a demonstration experiment. So my question is the first one, what is your favorite dog? And you can write that in the chat, or you can unmute and tell me what's your favorite dog. Probably most people are interested in writing in the chat. My students just write in the chat so much. So I'm gonna type mine in here. Here's German Shepherd, Beagle, Husky, Poodle, German Shepherd. We had some kind of a spaniel mutt when I was growing up, a pug or a poodle, a Pekingese. All right, these are all great dogs. And a husky, I hope I've read them all. All right, an American bulldog mix. So people really have dogs that they like the best. Husky and a corgi. Okay, someone has two dogs. All right, and so dogs can be large or small. Dogs can have all these different colors: red, black, white, pattern. They can have fluffy hair or short hair, or there are even some that are called no hair. And according to the American Kennel Club, these are the 10 most popular dogs in America. So Labrador Retriever, I need to move my labels here. Yorkshire Terrier, German Shepherd, Golden Retriever, Beagle, Dachshund, Boxer. Oh, someone wrote down Bloodhound as well. People like a bunch of different dogs. So that's really fun. Shih Tzu, Minter Schnauzer, Boxer, Poodle. Okay, so. And so we're going to start with the genetics of dog coat color. And shown here are some letters, and you see them in uppercase and you see them in lowercase. And so it looks like alphabet soup already. And we're just going to do a little bit with genetics. Dog coat colors come from two pigments made in the epidermis or skin of the dogs. The first one is the black pigment. Its name is eumelanin. It affects the coat color of the animal, the eye color, and the nose color. Then there's a second pigment or color molecule called pheomelanin, and it affects the coat color only. So how can we tell that? By looking at these pictures of cute Labrador puppies. The black pigment in the black dog is giving rise to the black coat, black eyes, and black nose. The red pigment only is in the this red dog. It's actually called a yellow lab. And you can see it has a yellow coat. But what color are the eyes and the nose? Aren't they still black? So that red pigment only affects the coat color. And most dog coats have both pigments, except for this type of white dog. And this type of white dog is lacking both of these pigments. But notice it still has a black nose and the brown eyes. All right, so not only do we have the genes for these two pigments, we also have a lot of controlling genes, and we're not going to get through anywhere near this number. So the controlling genes include A, B, D, E, G, H, K, M, S, T. You'd have to study a while to learn about all of these. The genes for the two pigments and then controlling genes that determine when the genes are on or off, and then also where they are on the animal, lead to many colors. And so these colors are listed here. And so going to dog-learn.com is a fun place to look for all the colors. They have interesting names like liver, which we now call chocolate, like a chocolate lab. Apricot is another color, fawn and lilac. There are also a lot of interesting patterns, and going to that same website, there are many more than I'm showing you here. One is this brindle or striped coat color, and then others are dotted, and there's some other coat colors as well. They have interesting names like brindle, merle, agoutie, and phantom. All right, so where are we going to start? And we're gonna try to keep it simple. I've been using words like genes already, so what am I talking about? So the DNA in our cells is on chromosomes, which is DNA that's kind of bunched up together. And these chromosomes are in the nucleus, and that's what this picture is showing. This cartoon is showing us that here is the DNA. It looks like a twisted ladder. And then it's all bunched up into chromosomes, which we can see as little X's. And they're located in a special part of the cell called the nucleus. Dogs have the genus and species name Canis familiaris, and they have 78 chromosomes. Shown here is what 78 chromosomes look like. This is actually those X's I was showing you, but when the chromosomes are released from the nucleus of an isolated dog cell, and you take a photograph, it looks like B, and then in A here, they have it stained so you can see a little better how long the chromosome is and what it looks like. Humans have 46 chromosomes. So having 78 or 46 chromosomes doesn't make one better than the other, it just makes us different from dogs. All right, on our DNA, we have genes, and the genes code for expression of what the animal is going to look like or how it's going to behave. And a gene can have two versions. So shown on this slide is a chromosome on the left and a different chromosome on the right. You and I have two sets of chromosomes. We get one set from Ma and we get one set from Pa. We get one from our maternal parent and one from our paternal parent. Now our parents have the same genes because they're both humans. They have them in the same order on the same chromosomes, but they might have different versions. So you might get your hair color from your father, and you might get your eye color from your mother in terms of the versions of the genes that show up in you. All right, so going back again to this drawing is showing two chromosomes, one from Ma and one from Pa, and they have different versions of this gene. The gene would be called gene B, and we have Pa's giving a little B and Ma's giving a big B. And these are two different versions of the genes. Okay. So this gene, big B, big little B, is a controlling gene. And in Labrador retrievers, it controls whether the lab is black or chocolate in color. Okay, so remember, every dog has two sets of genes, one from Ma and one from Pa. And so it can have a bunch of combinations of letters big B and little b. So let's take a look at a black lab. A black lab always has to have one big B, And that big B can come from Ma, that big B can come from Pa, or it can come from both. So in our my genetics book that I teach from, they put the version of the gene from Pa first. They put the version of the gene from Ma second. And so an animal that's big B, big B, got a big B from both parents. An animal that's big B, little B, got a big B from Pa and a little B from Ma. And an animal that's little B, big B, got a little B from Pa and a big B from Ma. And as long as they have at least one big B, they have a black fur. All right, we have the case, the remaining case, where the animal received a little B from both parents. And if they're little B, then they're chocolate. Isn't this an adorable picture? Okay. So are there any questions so far? Any questions? So this is all about dogs, but it works the same for humans. Many, many genes actually control our skin color and control our eye color. And we're just looking at the first set of genes for dogs. So we can do something called a Punnett square, and you might have done a Punnett square. Perhaps you're learning it in middle school or in high school, and we do them in college as well. Are there any other kinds of colors that are different? Big B and little B is a question in the chat. Yeah, there's one more, and that's going to be, we'll get to that with the next gene. So I like how you're curious and thinking ahead. So there are actually a large number of color combinations, but we're just going to get to black, chocolate, and yellow. So the hint is yellow, but it's not with B, it's with gene E. Okay. All right, so here's a Punnett square to look at a cross. So let's say we have big B by big B. And can you write in the chat, are we expecting black puppies? Are we expecting chocolate puppies? Are we expecting black and chocolate puppies? We're working on this first one. Black, all right. Okay, so the guesses look pretty good. Let me show you how to do a Punnett square. I'm gonna grab a drawing tool here. Okay, so to do a Punnett square, we're gonna put the genetic contributions of both parents. And we're gonna put them on this chart. The chart itself is called the Punnett square. And I'm going to type because I don't write very well with a mouse here. So the paternal parent is traditionally put over here. We have the parent is big B. The dad is big B. He can either donate the first big B or he can donate the other big B. And so that would be in the gamete or sperm in this case. The mother is big B, and she can donate either a big B, the first big B, or she can donate the second big B. And then in each of the four squares, we write the chance that an animal will get the alleles, particular alleles from the parents. So they get a big B from dad and a little B from ma. And in fact, that's going to happen in all four. So everyone who wrote in the chat is correct. All four chances out of four are going to be black. So if you have a black lab mated with a black lab and they're both big B, all the offspring are going to be black. All right, let's get to the next case. We have big B's as the dad, and little B as the mom. So we have a black and a chocolate lab. Let's check this out. I forgot to ask you what you thought it would be. but I've already given the answer. Oh, okay. So people are saying black, black, brown, or both. And here's the answer, actually. So you might want to amend your answer. Let's see why this is. Okay, yeah, so let's see how this is. All right. I'm drawing my Punnett square here. Got to use some straight lines. All right, so the dad can donate either the first big B or the second big B. So this half the time he'll donate this big B and half the time he'll donate this B, big B. Ma can donate little B and or the first little B or the second little B. So let me write down what the genes that are transmitted to the offspring are. So the first offspring has a quarter chance of being big B, little B. Okay, because they get the big B from dad and they get the little B from mom. But isn't that the case for all of these? And in fact, it is. Now, the principle we want to look at from here, this cross, is that big B for black is dominant over little B for chocolate or brown. Okay, and so we're saying big B is dominant over little B. So when the animal is big B, little B, the big B dominates in the way the animal looks, the animal is black. And so someone wrote here about a mix. So there's not a mix in what the animals look like. These are black dogs, but they are able to have potentially brown puppies. Okay, so they could donate a little B and these black dogs could maybe have brown puppies. So that's pretty interesting. So we get some surprises when we do these crosses. All right, are there any questions there? Did people understand that big B black is dominant? I guess the second half of this is little B is recessive. So when we have big B, little B, the big B dominates. All right. Well, you've actually completed the first half of chapter two in our college level book. Okay. All right, so let's try another one. This time we have big B, little B, mated with big B, little B. And I'm gonna remember to ask you first, what kind of puppies, what are the chances and colors for puppies this time? All right, and you could even do a little Punnett square if you have a little piece of paper there, or if you can like to solve problems in your head. So I'm seeing black, I'm seeing mix. And so the person who wrote mix, are you meaning some black and some chocolate? Okay. All right, we're getting some great guesses. Three black and one brown, more likely black, possibly brown. Okay, let's keep going with our Punnett square here. All right, we've got the next one and I've got the answers are out already. And so a couple of people might have been introduced to this before and or they're really good at solving, thinking on their feet here. All right, so we do our Punnett square again. Pa is gonna give a big B, half a chance of giving a big B, half a chance of giving a little B. Ma has half a chance of giving a big B and half a chance of giving a little B. So when we write down their genotypes, the genes that were donated by the parents is what I mean there. The first one looks like it's big B, big B. So there's a quarter chance that it will be big B, big B, and have black fur and will always give a big B to its puppies. There is a one half chance that it is big B, little B, or big B, little B, big B. It is black, but half the time it can pass on a little B. So maybe it can have chocolate colored puppies. And then here's the one quarter, here's the change. This last chance is a quarter chance that it will get a little B from Ma and a little B from Pa and be little B and be chocolate in color. So we had some people say that we get three black puppies to one chocolate puppy. And I want to emphasize or tell you that this doesn't mean if you have four puppies, you will always get three black and one chocolate color. It means that if you had a breeding pair and you did hundreds of crosses and you had hundreds of offspring, let's say you had 100 offspring, about three quarters or 75 would be black and one quarter or 25 would be chocolate. But the numbers are never exact. And what we're saying by this is if you have one puppy, it has a three quarter chance of being black and a one quarter chance of being chocolate. So the numbers are about chances. They're about chances to be either black or chocolate. Okay, and I'm going to review that again because that's a little tricky. So we'll keep moving on. All right. Are you folks then ready for the summary, which is that gene B for black is dominant over little b for chocolate? And if we were to summarize all the ways that the animal can get a gene from Pa and a gene from Ma, we could summarize and say if they have at least one big B, it gives a black coat color. So that would be big B dash. And then for chocolate, the summary would be all the chocolates have to be little b. So I've written those summaries in yellow. All right, so we can investigate a little further. And I hope you like that photo there. I want to do a second gene. And we had someone in the chat ask, are there any other colors that are possible? So using two genes, we can get to three colors. Okay, and you know, there are a lot more labs than this. You know, there's that white lab. We're not even going to get to the white lab. All right, so the EE gene, big E, little E gene, controls whether a lab has a yellow coat color or another coat color, which in our gene system is black or chocolate. Okay, and I'm seeing a question in the chat. Is it the same for cats? When I looked, I think these two genes are the same for cats. Yes. So mammals seem to share a lot of the same coat color. Not all, I don't know if they're all, so I'm not a veterinary. I don't know veterinary science. I teach biological science. A great question. All right, so big E, little E controls whether you get yellow or another color. And let me show you the rules right up front. So little E gives yellow, and that's the rule. If the animal has little E, it's called yellow. If it has at least one big E, and we're going to symbolize that by big E dash, it gives not yellow. In the case of our labs, that includes black or chocolate. And big E dash really stands for three different ways that the animal can inherit E from the parents. It could inherit big E from Pa and little E from Ma. It could inherit little E from Ma and, little E from Pa and big E from Ma. Or it could inherit big E from both animals, and then it will be either black or chocolate. All right, so let's put these together. I want you to help me with the rules for what are the rules for B and E genes together to give black, chocolate, and yellow labs. So we want to end up, there are many, many ways that the animal can inherit E and B. But we want to write a rule with those dashes. What's the rule for black? What's the rule for, I think I do chocolate second, and what's the rule for yellow? All right, so here we have all the animals with black fur, and they have, what do they share? What are their similarities in terms of these genes that show at the bottom? Do they all share one specific letter? Okay, the black has to be big B, so well done. So someone's writing, they have to have at least one big B, and at least one big E. Do they have to have more than one? Okay, wow. You folks are sharp. Okay, all right. All right, Owen, yep, and little B has to be, is chocolate. Okay, so let's do them one at a time. Let's do black first. So the rule for a black lab using the two genes E and B only, and remembering that we actually have, looked like 10 genes for coat color and pattern, the rule would be if you have at least one big E, and if you have at least one big B, then the coat color of the animal will be black. The second allele will help determine what pups this black furred dog can have. So that's pretty cool. You're already writing the rules for why animals look the way they do. All right, let's try the next rule. I don't have my slides up. I think I'm doing chocolate next. And someone already wrote that you have to be little b. And then what's the rule about E? So I'd like a rule for E and B together. What you got for me? Okay. All right, people are picking right up on this. Okay, you have to have at least one big E and you have to be little b. Okay, so let me show you that. Here for the chocolate lab, the rule is you have to have at least one big E, and you can get that from either ma, pa, or both, but you have to have little b, and then you get the so-called chocolate lab. Okay, last one. What's the rule for the yellow labs using the letters E and B? Okay, this one's the hardest. I saved it for last. There we go. Okay. So this one is a little bit complicated. Can you see that for B, you could have big B. You could have big B, little b. You can have little b. So basically you can have any B, but you have to have little e. All right, you're figuring that out. So I love that. So the rule for yellow lab is little e, and it doesn't matter what you have for B. So I wrote little e, --, for what's happening at B. Yep. Okay, so I think you get it. And so that's the second half of chapter two at a college level. And you all are doing pretty well. Amazing, come take my class sometime. Okay, so I just want to show you one last one. And this harks back to a question someone asked before. Could we ever get something weird? Like, could we get a yellow puppy when we mate a black dog with a chocolate dog? Okay. And so I have the answer already set up for you, and I've drawn out the Punnett square. And let me just put in the lines. So here are the lines, just so you know, because we're doing two genes, we have more lines. And this is a simplified Punnett square. The paw is has big E, little e, big B, little b, and has a quarter chance of donating big E, big B in his sperm, a quarter chance of donating big E, little b, a quarter chance of donating little e, big B, a quarter chance of donating little e, little b. Ma is big E, little b, little b. She has a half a chance of donating big E, little b, and she has a half a chance of donating little e, little b. So this is going to be chances when this mating is done, and if a lot of puppies are born, you could then count up the number that are black, chocolate, and yellow. And so yes, you can cross a black and a chocolate lab, and you can end up with 2/8 chance of having a yellow lab. There are other ways to get yellow labs, but this is one. And this is what makes genetics so fascinating and so fun. As you do crosses, you can find some surprising results. Okay. Are there any questions here? And I must say, I am impressed. You all did a great job on this. Okay. All right. I want to move on to our second topic here. And this is Saving the Wolves of Isle Royal. And I mentioned that the way we classify dogs is Canis familiaris, and the way we classify wolves is Canis lupus. And then these names that I'm giving to you are in Latin, and it's the genus and species name. So every organism that is different from another and cannot interbreed with it has a different genus and species name. So I just threw that in. I thought you would find it fun. All right. And so here, I wanted to bridge from talking about dog coat color to talking about wolves. And I just want to throw in for you that there are wolves, deer, cats, dogs, and rodents can all have an agouti coat pattern. An agouti coat pattern has a banded appearance. And so I don't know if you have a dog or a cat. My cat had agouti colored fur. Her fur was colored black and kind of orange yellow. So it was actually tipped with yellow. And this is an agouti hair. And agouti hair occurs when on the same hair, first the one pigment, eumelanin, that is black, is put down. And then on the same hair, the pheomelanin, which is orange, is put down. In this case, this has two stripes. My cat had just one yellow stripe. All right, so we're seeing in the chat that people have a dog and a cat, and you might have some agouti hair on your animal. You might not as well, but just wanted to show you some examples of agouti hair. So I want to just mention, why are dogs and wolves related together? And the gray wolf gave rise to dogs, and scientists doing genetic research of remains of ancient wolves and dogs, and then modern day wolves and dogs, have determined that probably dogs arose from wolves twice for us, it would be ancient history. So over 10,000 years ago, wolves were present, gray wolves were present all across the Northern Hemisphere, just below the ice sheets. And the wolves have a huge range, and they were able to interbreed. And so in two locations, there were some wolves that were a little less afraid of humans, and humans domesticated them, and their descendants became our dogs. So one of these places was in Siberia, and this gave rise to the Eastern dog progenitor, and that gave rise to East Asian and North American and South American dogs. And then the Western dog progenitor arose a little bit later, and they think that it arose here in the Near East, and it gave rise to Near East and African dogs. But then the dogs all intermingled, and people took dogs everywhere, and so the dogs are all one species. And dogs became a new species, Canis familiaris. So dogs evolved from the gray wolf. All right, I've got another question for you. So which is your favorite national park? I think I'm gonna take a look here. You can write that in the chat. What's your favorite park of any kind? State park, national park, the park down the street. I think my favorite park is whichever one I'm in. So I'm gonna write that in the chat. Okay, all right. Acadia Wilderness State Park. There's some great places. I love all of them. Right. The Porcupine Mountains, I just got there for the first time because I've had students recommending them to me for ages. I moved from out east. And all right. So people are going to keep writing what is their favorite park. Shown here is a picture of the park I'm going to talk about, Isle Royale. And this is one in Michigan. We're going to be talking about the wolves of Isle Royale. And so this is a picture taken from a helicopter. All right, so Isle Royale is way up north. So it is in Lake Superior. And as you can see, it's called Isle because it's actually an island. And in order to get there, you have to drive. And then most people get there by boat. You have to take a ferry, a boat that takes you across, and then you can go to this national park. So that being said, not many people visit because I had to ride on the ferry 3 hours or 5 hours, depending where you hop on. All right. And so Isle Royale in the early 1900s didn't have any wolves. However, Lake Superior would often freeze up and wolves were able to cross over. And they know that the wolves crossed over the ice in 1949 or 1950 and they stayed. So can you see the picture of the wolf here? This caused a food chain to develop, and the food chain was the wolf were eating a number of different prey, but the one I want to talk about right now are moose. And so moose are giant plant-eating mowing machines up there in Isle Royale. If there are no wolves around, they will eat everything. And I'm showing you down here the type of things they eat. Okay, you can't see my screen share. So in order to see my screen share, generally, maybe you have to check your screen view there. So can everyone else see my screen share? Okay, and maybe someone could help. We've got one person who's having trouble. Maybe give a little advice about how to change what you're seeing in order to see it. Okay. All right, so let me stop sharing and I'll see if I can do this again and help people out with screen sharing. All right. So if your internet connection is a little bit slow, it might take just a minute to share in order to see it. So I'm going to describe in words what I'm showing as well. Okay. So someone is having a little trouble seeing, and maybe it'll. Okay. And everyone else is able to see it?
Yes, and I'm emailing with Betty to see if we could correct it, Emily.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much. All right, there is a food web of Isle Royale, and so we can see the food chain, gray wolf, moose, and then all the plants. And we see it more complicated with more predators, such as the raven and red fox added. And we can see that the predators eat multiple prey, and the prey is red squirrel, snowshoe hare, moose, and beaver. Prey is also known as meat. And then the prey themselves eat plants, including pine, maple, balsam fir, aspen, and aquatic plants. Okay, so this is the food web that developed. Why do gray wolf not eat red fox? Well, they have to catch them. And so this is just a slide serve. I think the ravens are scavengers and they eat everything. So I see a question, and the question is, the questioner believes that this is incomplete. And I think that I would agree with you. So that's a good criticism. So the gray wolf would also eat red squirrel. The raven would also eat the remains of these other animals. A food web would have more crossing over here. Okay. All right, so the wolves control the moose, which otherwise eat up the vegetation. And this is showing how the wolf population and the moose population interact. So here they're counting number of wolves, and the scale is over here. We can see that the number of wolves ranges from only two up to a high of 50. And there were 50 in about the year 1980. Now the number of moose is given over here on the right-hand side, and the number of moose ranges from 500 to 2,500. And let's see over time how these vary. So from 1960 to 1980, we can see increasing numbers of moose, wolves, from 20 wolves to 50 wolves. And we can see varying numbers of moose, but as the wolves really increase, the number of moose decline. Then we see the wolves have declined in numbers, and we see the numbers of moose, they really rise, right? And then there's a severe winter, and it really limits the moose population because they can't find enough vegetation to eat. But I want to call your attention to the right-hand side of the graph here. And this is what's happening very recently. So over here, you can see the numbers of wolves, and we get down to how many wolves right down here at the bottom in 2018. You can write that in the chat. How many wolves? So we're reading from this scale over here, and it's less than 10. So it doesn't quite hit zero. Yep. So something like it actually got down to two wolves. And so the question is, what's the problem and how are they fixing it? So climate change changed the breeding patterns. Do you remember I told you how wolves have a huge range, which means when they get trotting, they are trotting all around, and they go and visit all kinds of places in order to find food and to find mates. So they travel many, many miles. If you have a dog, you know the dogs like to roam. If you let them. All right, so the wolves have a big range, but they can only get from the mainland to the island if the ice freezes over, and they can walk on the ice. So climate change has made more warmer winters, and the breeding with the mainland wolves stopped. So then we had a very small population, 50 wolves on the island, and they kept breeding with each other. And they were breeding with close relatives. This is called inbreeding, and inbreeding led to defects in the offspring. And it started with the wolf babies having crooked spines, extra vertebrae and ribs, and so it made it harder for them to survive. By 2017, they were down to one breeding pair that were highly related, and they couldn't have puppies. Their puppies didn't survive. So what's the problem? So going back to genetics, you have two wolves that are very related. And let's say for one particular gene set, G, they're big G, little G. So Pa has half a chance of giving big G and half a chance of getting little G. And Ma's the same. So we have 1/4 chance of getting a little G wolf baby. And what if that little G doesn't survive? Okay, so that means if you have very closely related parents, they're going to have a lot of babies that don't survive. All right, so the problem was we had too few wolves left on Isle Royal, and the remaining wolves were inbred and very highly related. So the solution was to translocate, which means to move, 19 gray wolves, and they moved them from Minnesota, Ontario, and Michigan, the Upper Peninsula. They moved them by helicopter onto Isle Royal to increase the population and to increase the diversity. And so these are some of the photographs from the translocation. And so they net the animals from a helicopter. So they throw down a net, and then they tranquilize the animal. They tape up its jaw so if it wakes up, it won't bite anyone. They move it to Isle Royal, and they take a little bit of blood samples because they want to know how related they are to each other, because they're looking to increase how unrelated they are They want ones that are unrelated. And then when the animal wakes up, it is released. And so now they have a number of these wolves. And so that's pretty fun. A number of wolves on Isle Royal. All right, and it's working. And I have a picture. This is not from Isle Royal, but the wolves are breeding. They're making young that can live. And I'm going to see if I can. I have a video. And the video is of a wolf. And she's teaching her baby wolf pups how to howl. Okay. See if we can go there. All right, I'm going to stop sharing so I can make sure you hear this. All right, it says very small picture. And down below, this is a musician interested in how you would take the pitches of the wolf cries and write it down as music. And they're interested then in how similar the wolf pup is to the mom. So let's take a listen. Okay. I just thought that was wonderful. All right. So these are cute wolf puppies. All right. I just wondered if any of you were fans of Game of Thrones and the dire wolf ghost, who is I guess accompanies Jon Snow, one of the characters. I just threw that in for you. Okay. All right. I'm looking at the time, and we have just enough time for me to show a little demonstration that I videotaped for you. And this is how to extract DNA from strawberries. So when the scientists who are translocating wolves to Isle Royal are studying the wolves to see how closely they're related, they have to extract DNA. And so I just wanted to show you, you can do this with simple items in your kitchen. You can do it and follow along with the video. So you're not going to be able to get these supplies right now. I'm going to give you the list of supplies and then show you a video of how to do it. And this video can be watched on replay. And so you could extract DNA yourself. And here's some DNA. It looks a lot like snot from your nose, actually. And so that's pretty silly. I recommend you protect your eyes, wear glasses if you have any. You're going to be using rubbing alcohol, and you keep that away from children and dispose of all solutions safely. So you'd want to tell your parents about this. The supply list is you're going to need rubbing alcohol, measuring cup, spoons, 3 large strawberries with the green tops cut off. You're going to make a DNA extraction solution with 1/2 teaspoon of salt, 1/3 cup of water, 1 tablespoon of dishwashing soap, a stir stick or bamboo skewer, scissors, funnel, cheesecloth, and a tall thin glass jar. So I'll show you this video now.
Hello, everyone. I'm Emily Thompson, and I am volunteering to show you how to extract DNA from strawberries. So this may surprise you, our topic for getting the DNA. Humans have 2 copies of every chromosome in the majority of our cells. We are said to be diploid. We get 1 set from Ma, and we get 1 set from Pa. Strawberries, because of commercial growing, have gone from diploid to
tetraploid. Let me and now they're octoploid. Turn this off. All right, so people are not able to see that video. I have it on in a different format. Let me try it in this format. Thank you for telling me. Let's try it here. Okay.
And I am volunteering to show you how to extract DNA from strawberries. So this may surprise you, our topic for getting the DNA. Humans have two copies of every chromosome in the majority of our cells. We are said to be diploid. We get one set from Ma and we get one set from Pa. Strawberries, because of commercial growing, have gone from diploid to tetraploid, and now they're octoploid. And as they have changed in ploidy, they have increased in size, where the diploid ones are as big as your little finger, and the tetraploid ones are perhaps a centimeter. And now we have large octoploid strawberries that humans find fun to eat because they're so large. In order to do this experiment, I have a list of supplies for you below, and you can follow along with me. You can turn your video on and off as we go. It's going to be pretty fast, though. The first thing you're going to need are your three strawberries, and you're going to need to hull them, which means you need to pull off or cut off the green part here. I've actually hulled mine using a knife. I find that easier. So you're going to have three of those. You're going to put them into a resealable plastic bag. And this bag, you're going to burp most of the air out of it and seal it up. It is helpful also if you already have your rubbing alcohol in the freezer. So mine is frosty cold. And I've already made my extraction liquid in order to get started. So in an old olive jar, I have placed a half teaspoon of salt, a third cup of water, and one tablespoon of liquid dishwashing soap, you know, the kind for hand washing dishes. All right, let's get started. You put those three strawberries in a bag and you mush them for 2 minutes. You can turn off your video. When you come back, your extract from strawberries should look approximately like this. It's pretty messy. Now we're going to actually get the DNA out of the cells. So we've broken up the strawberries, but a lot of the cells are still intact. The cells are surrounded by lipid membranes, as is the nucleus. So we have to get through two sets of membranes to get the DNA out. We're going to put in 3 tablespoons of our extraction liquid. Again, that's half teaspoon of salt, a third cup of water, and a tablespoon of dishwashing liquid. We're going to put 3 tablespoons in. And at this point, I have an apron in my lap in case this gets messy. So there's 1, 2, and 3. And now in real time, I'm going to mush this. Whoops, I'm going to push some of the air out. There we go. And mush this for 1 minute. Tum, tum, tum. So your kids will like to do this. All right, we're breaking open the cells. We are making what's called a lysate. When we break open cells, we are lysing them, L-Y-S-E. This is a Greek word. And at this point, the DNA is starting to flow into our solution. We have salt in the solution, and the DNA is binding to the salt, and this is going to help us precipitate it out at the appropriate moment. All right, so new use for dish soap here. I have that about a minute has passed. I have placed a filtering solution. I've got another spice jar. In it, I've placed a funnel, and I have cheesecloth in there, or you can fold up a coffee filter and open up just 1/4 of that. I'm going to use scissors or a knife to snip my bag, and I'm going to pour out the liquid, and hopefully not too much of the still solid strawberries. And so I'm going to squeeze this through. And what we're doing is we're pulling out all the large cellular matter, strawberry bits, seeds, and cell matter. And we're basically straining it through the cheesecloth. Okay. All right, and the instructions are to, fill up this jar, maybe a quarter full. We're getting pretty close. All right, I would say that's close to a quarter. Next, I'm going to take my icy cold rubbing alcohol, and it asks for 1/2 cup, but we may not need all of that. I'm going to layer in on the top, I'm going to layer in 1 inch of rubbing alcohol. In order to do this, I'm going to tilt both of my jars and gently pour it in. Let's see if I can see this. Let's see if I got, all right, I have about a centimeter. Maybe I'll put more in. All right, it is pouring in my lap. And now I'm taking my stir stick. Oh, I can see my DNA. I'm going to take my stir stick and dip it down and pull the DNA up and try to precipitate it in the alcohol. There it goes. And I'm trying to wrap it on my stir stick. Oh, I'm getting it. It's just very large amounts of DNA. Very cool. It is very sticky. And I'm trying not to mix my two layers. I am trying to wrap it around my stick. It's a little hard to see, but my stick is getting nice and thick. Now, if you're very good at wrapping this, I'm used to precipitating it out using a centrifuge in the lab. So I don't know if you can see, I'm starting to get lumps of the DNA on here.
Okay, I just wanted to show you a technique for extracting DNA that can be done in your kitchen with parental supervision. And it's really fun. You can see the little picture that I have of the DNA on the end of the stick. And again, it does look a lot like snot, but this is the molecule of inheritance, DNA. And so I want to know, do you have any questions as we're ready to close out the hour here? Any questions? All right. No, actually, so I'm going to finish out and then Susan Dantella will close it out. I just want to say, keep staying curious, everyone. Ask questions, find answers, and thank you so much for attending.
Thank you so much, Dr. Thompson. This was marvelous. This was really marvelous. I enjoyed it. And I hope you all think about doing that experiment at home. I think that would be really marvelous. So our next session is actually next month, because we have a session every month. I think someone was asking about a session. Our next session is November 5th, and it's Why Scientists Must Be Artists. And so you can register for that session. We'd love to have you there. And a big thank you to Emily Thompson. Thank you so much. That was really, really informative and fun, too.
My pleasure.
Oh, Amanda's birthday is November 9th. All right. Take care, everyone. Bye.